Okay, I think we're going to get started. I know that you all remember Margaret, who is our education associate, and she is going to introduce our next panelist, who is Dr. Kristi Brown-Montesano, and one of my big idols who I've admired for many years. And now I will shut up and please welcome Margaret.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me okay? Okay, perfect. Thank you, Kristi, so much for joining us. Very excited. So Kristi Brown-Montesano is the chair of music history at the Colburn Conservatory of Music, who has received her PhD in musicology from UC Berkeley with a specialization in 18th century Western European music. A trained vocalist studying with Stephanie Friedman and Jeffrey Thomas, Brown-Montesano was a longtime member of the American Bach Soloists. Her book, Understanding the Women of Mozart's Opera, offers a detailed study of the female characters in the DuPont operas and the magic flute, reevaluating common critical tropes and assumptions about this fascinating role. Brown-Montesano has presented and published essays on uses of classical concert music in film, trends in marketing opera, the Wagnerian influence on the films of Lars von Trier, and gender politics in contemporary classical music culture. Current projects include unraveling the mystery of Arthur Conan Doyle's choice of the violin for his fictional detective Sherlock Holmes, collaborating on a book on music in American television, an evaluation of post-war pop culture reception of J.S. Bach in the U.S., and a study on opera education in children. Thank you so much, Kristi Brown-Montesano, for joining us. And your bio is amazing, and there's a lot more. You can also find more information on her website, kristibrownmontesano.com.
Thank you so much, Margaret. Andrea, for having me here. I'm going to just say right away, of course, this morning, I keep getting a signal every 10 minutes or so saying that my internet connection is unstable, which is kind of like the world right now. So if you see me grow quiet, Andrea is going to let me know I need to repeat something, but hopefully it won't happen often. I'm going to start sharing my screen. I'm going to go back here. So welcome, hello from Zoom land, which we're all becoming very familiar with at this point. I'm happy that technology allows us not only to connect this morning, but also to connect in general with our students and our friends as we go forward. I also really appreciate all that teachers are doing right now. My youngest son is a high school senior. My daughter is a high school teacher. And I know that the challenges have come suddenly and really demanded from our teachers a lot of flexibility and a lot of extra time. So thank you very much. I hope that this presentation, which I've tweaked in order to be right for our COVIDian times, to emphasize some online possibilities, materials that you can look at. So my topic today, opera and children, has been of interest to me for at least 27 years when I had my first child and was at the same time writing my dissertation on the female characters of Mozart's operas. I'll offer a little historical context for the subject, some cultural background, and then hopefully get to some ways that would be useful to you and your students that can be used for engagement online and creativity that is favorable to an online format. So let's get started with one very important question. That is, what is opera today? And this may seem like it's an obvious thing, but I find that even with my college students, I have to go through definitions with them because they need it. And opera has a 400-year history, so we're not going to do that. We're really going to look at how most people think about opera today and how it commonly is experienced and performed in today's context. So let's look at a little bit at this. It's a collaborative art form. So we know that unlike a lot of genres in classical music, opera requires creative input from many different artists, basically, in different media. So you have obviously your music, which is both vocal and instrumental, the libretto, which is the play, the story. This is involving both narrative prose and poetry. And I know we'll hear later more about poetry. The sets, the whole staging of it requires creativity and construction in art, painting. Today we have a lot of projection, general design, lighting. These are all aspects of opera and a very important part of it. And then drama, which is includes also the stage movement, costumes, which are amazing, and makeup. And I did include in my little circles there, that's Big Stone there from the recent LA opera, Eurydice. I loved the makeup and costume of Big Stone there. You can see her giant stone head. So when you're thinking then about definitions, and you might ask your students, like if they had to say, what do you know about opera? What do you think it takes to make an opera? What things would have to be done? Here's a few ideas to work with. So number one, conventionally we understand opera today as a large scale, usually at least 2 hours long. It's a musical narrative form, which is staged. You can have concert performances where it's just the musicians and people sing without the acting, but that's a rarer form. Usually you're expecting it to be staged. You want specially trained vocalists, and this is, I'll come back to this. This is, I think, one of the most fascinating aspects of opera is the kind of voice that is trained to sing it. And people are often either scared by that or fascinated or both. Full orchestra, generally, there are chamber orchestras, so you can have a smaller group. And in some performances, you can reduce it down to piano if necessarily. And another aspect of classical music in general, that if you're in a normal concert hall, you'll have an acoustic performance rather than an amplified performance. And that's another reason you need those specially trained voices. One of the early names that people gave for opera, because opera just means the work in Italian. So drama per musica, this idea of a story told through music. And the emphasis was on this musical presentation, that you sang it pretty much throughout. That was normally. Now there are, of course, opera forms that have recitative that is musical, and then sometimes you have spoken dialogue. But most opera that appears on stages today, that we'll get into that, tends to be music throughout, sung throughout. The visual component of opera, incredibly important, and it's going to be an area that I look at a little more closely, for especially for younger audiences. But I think in general, opera has always drawn a crowd because of the incredible stagecraft and what you could see and the effects. It was one of the most innovative genres in its, let's say, original forms in the 18th, well, pretty much from the 17th through the 19th century. Everybody liked the machines and the special effects. So the visual component of opera, very important. One important thing to keep in mind about today's opera culture is that the repertoire is dominated by a relatively small number of works and composers, mostly from the late 18th through the early 20th century. We often call this the canon. So the opera canon are those works that have been passed forward and continue to show up on the stages. And I even have my students who are college age students do a project where they have to look at 7 different houses around the world. They choose, they look at the season, the same season, and look for overlaps. And it shows them really how important some of these composers are, that you're going to see a lot of Bizet, Mozart, Rossini, Verdi, Wagner, Puccini. These are big names that show up. So it's, again, relatively small as a canon, as opposed to like a symphonic repertoire, which might have many more pieces being presented in a season. Opera houses tend to have fewer productions. There are a few houses like the Met, but especially like Vienna, and also I believe Moscow, have huge seasons of 30 and 40 operas. So what I also noticed is things like Carmen, Traviata, Marriage of Figaro, Magic Flute, La Boheme, Tosca. These show up almost all the time in the top five performed operas around the world. And as I said already, these are mostly sung throughout. There are a few non-Italian comic or semi-serious genres, and this would include the Magic Flute, or even more recently, Weill's Rise and Fall of the City of Mahagoni, where there is spoken dialogue. We associate that today more with musical theater, where you're going to have a song, but then a lot of dialogue, and then another song comes out. So that does happen with operatic works, but it's less common. So in this context, where does opera for children come into play? And scholars have definitely, musicologists like myself, have found kind of early examples for children even in the 18th century. But for the most of its history, opera has been an overwhelmingly adult entertainment. Whether it was the early aristocratic circles that had private performances, or later in the public theaters, opera was a social event, and a place for social display as much as a musical event. And that was generally enjoyed by grown-ups. This is not to say that there weren't spectators who we would consider minors today. Partly that's because Western society has changed its ideas. There's a constantly evolving, developing definition of childhood. And it's in the recent years that we definitely see a separate category, I would say in the last century, of the child as reader. For instance, you see that in the growth of children's literature and more contemporarily, the young adult literature today. So there may have been younger people seeing opera, but they weren't going there as a children's opera. Children's opera starts to really take off much in the same way that literature for children took off, and we see it growing. However, one thing is that opera for children is not a huge moneymaker. It is not something that gets the main stage for a long time or is brought back for that. I think it probably could be, and there are a couple of older works we'll look at that do that, but it tends to be a more private, in the classroom or for a school, or as LA Opera has done, they create a different shorter version, an adaptation of an opera story using the music and changing the story. But those are not generally something that is put on then for many, many people over and over again. So one thing I want to make clear, I am not ruling out bringing children to any main stage opera that's being presented. This isn't about censorship, but I think it's interesting that until recently, opera DVDs, like most performing arts DVDs, did not have any kind of rating. And now you see that those are starting to show up and that opera companies are starting to put kind of age-appropriate limitations, like this is better for 10 and up, or this is better for 5 and up. So it lets you know a little bit. So the opera world is adapting to this idea of curating their programs, including some kind of age limit. So the types of operas that tend to be thought of for children, there are different. I'm just gonna give a few examples and some categories. The first would be canonic works, so works that have been around for a long time and that we are now categorize as family operas. And here are four of the more common ones: Mozart's The Magic Flute, Rossini's Cinderella, Humperdinck's Hansel and Gretel, and Janáček's The Cunning Little Vixen. The Magic Flute is definitely kind of it's considered a gateway opera now for families and younger audiences. It was not intended as that so much when it was created, but it does have a strong fairy tale foundation. And in the latter 20th century, the idea of the Magic Flute being an opera for children was strengthened by things like the Ingmar Bergman film, where the camera keeps focusing on a young child in the audience and her wonder. And that goes all the way up to the Metropolitan Opera's most recent manifestation of the Magic Flute. This was Julie Taymor's production. And if you don't know Julie Taymor, she was behind the fabulous Lion King Broadway production with all of the puppets. And so she created a production for the Met in 2006. And that was also broadcast as the first live in HD. It was meant mostly for schools. And it later became the Met's first live in HD DVD of that series. So they put a lot, they invested a lot. Currently it is often alternated with Hansel and Gretel as the Met's holiday offering. So it's now kind of been nutcrackerized as well. Obviously Cinderella and Hansel and Gretel both trade strongly on the fairy tale basis of the stories. And so they are naturally child friendly in a sense. Humperdinck's opera was intended as a child's opera. He actually wrote it at the instigation of his sister, who wanted something for her own children, and she adapted the fairy tale story for her libretto. So it actually has a different ending than the kind of Grimm and other earlier forms of Hansel and Gretel. And Janáček's The Cunning Little Vixen looks a lot like a Disney thing. There are anthropomorphic animals that are the main characters. Most of these canonic operas are, I should say, between 90 minutes and 3 hours long. So that's often prohibitive as well. Sometimes they are shortened for family forms. On the other side, you have newer family, child-friendly operas. I've included an insane one, this Menotti's Help, Help, The Global Links. This is a very weird opera, but you can find it online. There's a full YouTube production, movie style. He makes these crazy and they are represented by electronic music, and the children save the world by playing, basically music saves the world. So it's kind of against electronic world music, which is perfect for its 1968 timestamp. But the violins come out and we're saved by music. So you can find that, and I will put together a list of resources for you. Neuson's Where the Wild Things Are, obviously based on the famous Sendak book. That one is not really available easily online, but I wanted to put that as this was created for children and intended, it's building on a child's book. Portman's The Little Prince, you can find snippets of this, and that's again based on a storybook. And more recently, Turnage's Coraline, based on Neil Gaiman's book, and we've also seen the movie. Again, one of these issues is access, and we'll come back to that. There have been also, especially from mid-20th century forward, a strong emphasis on community and children's operas. This also happened in Stalinist Russia, but that's a different issue. More recently, Benjamin Britten has not only Noyo's Flood, based on the biblical story, and that's been performed, in fact, by LA Opera as a community event, I know, at the Cathedral of the Angels. And Andrew Norman more recently wrote something for the LA Phil Symphonies for Schools. Some of you may have heard of this. It's in 2018, A Trip to the Moon. And that brought together a variety of sources. Georges Méliès' original small silent film, A Trip to the Moon, and also the Jules Verne book about this. So he put that together, brought it up to one point, and then created his own ending for that trip to the moon. And along with all of these, and these have certainly been important to the LA Opera and educational connection department, these strategies, these mini versions or adaptations of canonic works, so taking the idea and the music of a work, but then creating your own story that would be more engaging perhaps for younger viewers. A lot of new short works have been written. This is particularly common in England, in the UK, where they have a strong amateur music tradition, historic tradition. I met people at a recent conferences that were actually hired by the opera companies to be their young person composers. So they would, that was part of their job, was to create shorter operas for children. There's a lot of storytelling. You can read a book and then there are little songs inserted. I know that Houston Grand Opera does this, and you'll hear the story and then somebody will come to your classroom, read the story and sing the songs in an opera style. And then there's also been a tradition, and I heard about this as well, where they'd have students create their own operas by learning pre-existing music and inserting it, sometimes writing new words. So all of these are great developments that are happening in the area of opera engagement, opera works for children. The problem in our current situation, where I really believe live creativity, and I know all of you, this is much easier as teachers, the live group creativity is much easier than each of us siloed in our Zoom pod. So access to these materials and access to kind of collaborative creativity is a little more challenging. I will try to provide some ideas. There are older works that you can watch on YouTube. Some of them have subtitles, but a lot of them don't. And even then, and this is why I wrote quality, you often need to watch the whole thing yourself so you can really understand. An example of a problem with quality in a larger sense, many Magic Flute full productions that are on YouTube that have the subtitles in English, which is great, also present representational problems. There is a character, Monostatos, who is a black slave in the original form of the Magic Flute. And many productions well into, I mean, almost to the 21st century, were still using blackface for that particular character. And the character as portrayed also is, he's portrayed as a villain. So there are problems with that. So you should, anything you're going to use, watch the whole thing yourself just to make sure that in terms of the age group you're teaching and the presentation. And I say that because it happened to me. I thought there was a great example of Der Freischütz, of this scene called the Wolfgang scene. It was, I think, Stuttgart. I put it up and it soon became pornographic and I had a very awkward moment with my students. So watch the whole film if you're going to be using anything like that. All right, so let's talk about the visual component. I think this is certainly one of the most important aspects. It is, we are a very visual culture now at this point, and it's one that is accessible online. You can get pictures of, you can see what kinds of creativity people have used to evoke a certain part of a story, including, I had here the marvelous production that LA Opera featured of Hansel and Gretel a couple years ago. So this is something that children, adults, I think, immediately go to. You could have students take a story like Hansel and Gretel. They could come up with their own ideas of how scenery, costumes, makeup could take place. How they could draw these, they could create, they could collect collages of images from the internet. I loved many of the things that Beatriz gave to us in terms of online resources for creativity for younger children, and some of the things I'll be presenting will dovetail with those. So this is one possibility. I want to show you two short trailers of Hansel and Gretel, the first one from LA Opera, the second one from the Canadian Opera Company. And you can see how they took the same Hansel and Gretel opera and story.
Oh,
Trailer, which you get quite a bit of great music there. You get to hear the vocals as well as the instrumentals from a kind of a slice from various scenes. Here's the second trailer. Let's see. In both of those, you can see that there's quite a different look. The use of projections and a more modern take on it. So there's a lot of variety there. You could probably find others. Those were two of the most kind of exciting that I found. Another part component that you can look at with kids is the narrative or dramatic component. I just found in a quick look at a number of different Cinderellas. We're past where you have to use the golden books of Disney or any of the films. I was very interested to see the different kinds of representation and storytelling around the Cinderella story. So these could also be a way, if you're able to share a couple of books, the different storytellings, and have them see these examples and create maybe a Cinderella story around themselves or someone they know or just in their imagination. This is, I think, a big part of it. And it's also exactly what Humperdinck's sister did. She took the Hansel and Gretel story and crafted it for a late 19th century family situation. The evil stepmother is not there. We have an actual mother, and the mother is harried and afraid, and they're very poor in a county that has so much food instability for many families. This is not a fairy tale. this is a reality. And there's a way to also let students express their own experience of being maybe afraid of something or wanting something, but their parents can't afford it. These kind of, and how parents fight, but then come back together. And that's a, it was changed dramatically for that story. And most opera librettos, you can find English translations online. So you could even take a scene from that and have your students read it and then think about how they might do it differently. So that's definitely part of the narrative dramatic component allows for a lot of at-home creativity for them to rethink stories and then maybe build the visual, how they would then costume, set design, et cetera, make up for those parts of that story. Finally, of course, the show depends on a musical component. It's interesting that if you look at the Pulitzer Prizes, for instance, an opera can win for music, a music theater piece like Hamilton wins for drama. So the emphasis on words for a musical theater piece is replaced by a kind of balance of music being the emphasis here. And music is broken down into two very important parts, the orchestral instrumental component, and of course, the vocals that carry the words, that carry the drama and the physical character that is manifested by the singer actor. So in general, I found that students are very, young people and most people are drawn to the vocal component, the just hugeness of the voice. And I found one video, which I thought was quite charming. It's kids, the Hi-Ho Kids videos, and this is Kids Meet an Opera Singer.
If I'm able to break this, I'd be really surprised. Michaela, I'm Angel.
My name is Blendon.
My name is Evan.
Evan, I'm Angel. It's nice to meet you.
Your dress is so pretty.
Thank you. So is yours.
Thanks.
Is this where you wear to work?
Yes, most of the time I wear something very similar to this.
So are you famous?
No.
Wow.
Are you a princess?
Do I look like a princess?
Yes, but you don't remind me of that.
Okay.
Well, kind of Tiana.
But... Kind of Tiana, okay. Do you guys want to see what I do?
Yes.
Do you like loud noises?
No.
No?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'll try not to be too loud, okay? So
give it to us.
What I do for a living is I go...
Oh. Are you a professional singer?
Yes, I am. I'm an opera singer.
I love your singing voice.
Thank you so much. That is very nice. Thank you.
Can you please show me some more?
Sure. Do you want to do some scales?
Wait, am I singing too?
Yeah. Bravo. That was awesome. Yeah.
When did you know that you were going to be an opera singer?
4 years old when I wanted to become an opera singer.
Wow.
And I started singing and taking voice lessons when I was six.
That's how old I am.
That's great. That's a perfect age to start singing.
Did you have to go to school to be an opera singer?
Yes, I did. Started studying voice with my dad. He was my very first voice teacher. And then I have a master's of music degree in opera performance from UCLA.
What's the highest note you could hit?
Probably a high G flat. What about you? What's the highest note that you can sing?
So there's a few more minutes of that available, but I love the children's expression and the fact that it's a real person and the force of that when it's the voice, when it's that close is fantastic. And you see that from their faces. You can also do a lot of comparison on how different things sound when the voice is added. You can always play snippets of operas and ask them what they think is happening in the drama. Mozart's Magic Flute is actually really good for that because the musical styles for the different arias are quite more pronounced than you might find in later operas. But you could also take something like the Wagner's Rite of the Valkyries here as an this is a snippet of an instrumental part. To get, they may know it from cartoons and other things that they may recognize that it's used on commercials and things, but having them listen to that. And then I found you can find clips online very easily of this Rite of the Valkyries scene. This one is from the Met and it shows them now with the vocals added as well as the visual component. And you could also introduce them to mythology. What are the Valkyries and what was their job and how were they portrayed in art? So there's lots of things. Here's the Met clip. Sorry, there we go. You can explain how the Valkyries play into giant teeter-totters on that staging, which usually gets a laugh from my students. So there's still a lot there that I think when we talk about music inspiring creativity, there's lots of ways that that can happen, even as listeners and thinkers and storytellers. Music fits very well into those. And there are resources available, as you've already heard, that should not be too difficult to incorporate into an online setting or to ask students to be able to listen to and then respond when you're together as a class. So I hope that this has been helpful in some ways as an introduction to the ways that children and opera are connecting in today's world. And now I can just open it up to questions.
Okay, I see. I think Esfer had a question. Hold on one second. Esfer, are you there?
Yes. I want to mention that, unfortunately, I don't remember the whole title, but I think LA Opera did years ago a fabulous production of Incredible Mr. Fox. That was children's opera.
Yes.
Yes. So.
Yeah, I just don't, I only put a few titles up there because yeah, they were just examples. There is a really interesting, and I'll include this in resources. There's a website that has snippets from operas written for children, and you don't see the whole thing all the time, but you can get snippets. It's like something like operaforchildren.com. And LA Opera, I think in the 90s, did something where somebody wrote from the immigrant's position, which I thought would really be great. When I was actually listening, I had some of the problems with the exoticization of the music. It actually sounded kind of stereotypically like pentatonic Asian. I may be more sensitive to that, but that when I put the list together and give it to Andrea for the department to go out to all of you, okay. That will be there.
Super, thank you very much.
Uh-huh.
Awesome. Thank you, Esper, for that question. And Dr. G.J. Christensen, I see your hand is raised.
Yes, Dr. Brown-Montesano.
Yes.
Interested in the possibility of what we could do with board games in the classroom, say for middle school and for high school. There are games now for how to set up an opera in different cities. There's a game out called Symphony Number 9, where you actually put together all the musicians and try to form a company so that Beethoven or an appropriate director could conduct. And I'm just wondering what the possibilities are in creativity for that.
Well, again, when we're separated from each other, it's a little more difficult. It's easier, I think. You could easily create group projects where people would take the different aspects of opera production, even publicity, and even you could really teach them about all the different people that have to come together to make a production, besides the musicians and the singers. But who's going to, and they could serve those roles. Like, what kind of poster would you create for your new opera? What would you say to other kids if you were trying to get them to come to your opera? You know, how would you, you know, those are things that I think are tied into other areas, including writing, analytical thinking, collaboration. You could have them do a budget for an opera. Like, you know, they're depending on how old, you say, okay, you only have this much money. You need to get these materials. You could try to find out where you're going to get those materials. And that could be for older students as well. So I think we don't know when we'll be back together in the classroom, there's ways of breaking that out and then bringing it all together and showing students what other students have created when they're submitted to the teacher. Eventually, I think you could create games that could be ongoing in a single classroom where each group would present what it has done, but also that you would try to stage the opera. I mean, I would enjoy with younger kids creating new words to known songs. If it's Happy Birthday, that's fine. And they would come on, dialogue the story, and then sing Happy Birthday to the new words. So I think there's a lot available, and we're just trying to think to adapt today for how teachers are having to finish probably this school year, at least partially online, if not the rest of the school year online. Does that answer the question?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. That was an amazing presentation. And I know that you had a couple of internet issues this morning. So I'm really grateful to you for making it work, and grateful to your family for accommodating
you. Thank you. Yeah, they were great.